the flickering light of Asia, or the Assyrian nation and church, the righteousness of the reparation claims of the Persian Assyrians against the Persian Azerbaijan government is based upon such positive facts that they cannot possibly be found open to any contradiction. While the previous massacre of the Christians in Urmia might be compromisingly attributed to the fanaticism of the Muslim mobs, all the succeeding outrages against the Assyrians were absolutely instigated by the Persian officials and inaugurated under the direct supervision. Thus, the hostilities of the Battle of Urmia were opened by Arshad el-Mulk, the commander of the Persian forces in Urmia. It was this individual who was the chief instigator of the Assyrian atrocities of 1914 to 1915. As a most bigoted fanatic, he was directly responsible for the deeds that had surpassed in their honors of the cruelty of the great Tartar conqueror. And because of the very atrocities and for his hellish deeds, he was elevated to his new position by the Governor General of Azerbaijan in Tabriz. It was also with his authority as the commander of the Persian troops in Urmia that the horsemen of Karadagh had been called in small and unsuspecting units to swell the hordes of Islam's fanatics for the inauguration, if possible, of a more successful jihad. The city of Urmia had a population estimated at 40,000. Of this total, the number of the native Assyrians did not exceed 2,000. The latter were generally grouped in the immediate neighborhoods of the three missionary centers, namely the American, the French Catholics, and the former Russian Orthodox mission quarters. The city from ancient times still remained enclosed within the walls of mud raised to considerable height. It has seven gates leading into seven main streets, all of which lead into its center, where the stores and the Ark bazaars are situated. In the immediate vicinity of the city, and within 1 to 3 miles from its western, eastern, and southern gates, stood the Christian towns of Charbash, Degela of Charbash, Degela, and Guktepe. The last two named towns possessed two artificial hills formed by the ashes of the never-dying fire of the ancient Zoroastrians, while the former town nestled itself on the skirt of a small mount made famous since by the martyrdom of an Assyrian bishop and his Christian companions. As a precautionary measure, General Agapetros had three batteries planted on the three commanding hills, ready for any eventuality that might arise. On February 9, 1918, some Assyrians who were passing through the street leading to the western gate of the city were fired upon and killed by the troops of Arshad el-Mulk. Instantly, the air thundered with the fearful shout of the jihad, drowning the rattling sound of the firearms as they began to spell revenge and destruction. Simultaneously with this outbreak in Christian quarters, a special force was sent by Arshad el-Mulk to surround Agapetros in his home. The general, however, even though surprised by the suddenness of the attack on him, personally never lost his head. He shouted to his family to shelter themselves immediately in the cellar of his house. Then single-handed, he manned the machine gun he had planted in a position within the building, and just for a possible day like this, while the walls and windows of his mansion were literally riddled by the bullets of the enemy. He thinned down so rapidly and so effectively the line of the attackers that they left the heaps of their dead and wounded and fled. Now the hostilities were opened in earnest, and the Assyrians must either assert their supremacy or else the last hour for the existence of the Christian people in this remote corner of Asia had come. The Assyrian troops were quartered not far from the city and within a hailing distance from one of its western gates. The Charbash battery, under instruction, was let loose into the city for the purpose of demoralizing the Muslims, while 150 men were ordered to face the enemy in the main street. In order to ascertain its strength in that vicinity, the Assyrians entrenched themselves at once and engaged the fire of the overwhelming numbers. This position they were to hold at all risks and hazards till they received further orders. In the meanwhile, 700 men were ordered to open a way through the section occupied by the Christians and reach in the rear of the main body by the Muslims. In order to accomplish this task unobserved, they had to break holes through the walls of the adjoining homes of the Christians. This was done very successfully. After these men had stationed themselves in commanding positions and had planted the two machine guns with which they were equipped, the general sent word to the 150 men who were still engaging the fire of the enemy to vacate their position and in their retreat to pretend that they were fleeing. But tremendous as the shout of victory was, it was all for a moment. Muhammad perhaps had changed his mind, or Hussein perhaps had been angry at the procrastination of his worshippers. The pursuers moved fast. They were almost trampling upon each other in their haste to get first at the Christians. The main street was black with the victorious troops of Arshad al-Mulk. The monotony of their uniform was broken by green and white garlands of Islam's double priesthood. The latter bore the bands of the holy war. They had come as far as the gate of the city when Aga Petros gave the signal to his men, who fell now in the rear of the enemy to fire. The famous horsemen of Karadag dropped like leaves, their bodies mingled with those of the shouting priests. The execution did not last more than 30 minutes. It was stopped again by Aga Petros, who called it a slaughter and not a battle. Here, a force less than 1,000 men had routed an enemy 10 times as large. And all this time, the patriarch and his people were praying not so much for the triumph of their defenders as the salvation of the Christian people from the relentless wrath of Islam. In front of the French hospital in Urmia, gathering the wounded after the first fight between the Assyrians and the Muslims, the American flag proclaiming its mission of mercy. But merciful deeds failed to touch the hearts of the vipers of Islam. The hostilities had apparently ceased. The patriarch and his general were contemplating as to what steps they should take on the following day, when shortly after midnight, the deed silence that had pervaded the city was suddenly broken by fresh thunders of the jihad. Arshad al-Mulk had the commander of the Persian troops, and Ijlal al-Mulk had not repented of their evil. A second attempt of the Muslims during the night was crushed in the bud by the same Christian troops, who remained stationed in the same positions which they had held during the day. In the first day of the battle, the entire western part of the city had fallen into the hands of the Assyrians. It was fully expected, however, that the Mohammedans would rally and attack again, and that perhaps a more crushing defeat would be necessary to bring the chief conspirators so as to leave the Assyrians alone. During the night, in addition to the troops who were stationed in the city and at one of the western gates, it was decided to occupy, by smaller units, some other positions in the southern part of the city, as also the gate situated near the American mission. At the southern gate was stationed Malik Khushaba, the Lion of Tiari, with some 200 of his own Tiari warriors. Their position faced directly the ancient ramparts of the city, which, as it became known in the morning of the following day, were held by very large forces of the enemy. In the rear of the Tiari troops, and about half a mile away, outside the city wall, stood another fort, occupied by the Karadag horsemen. The other two batteries stationed, one in Degala and the other in Guktapa, had received orders to be ready for action at sight of the signals. Early in the mornings of Saturday, February 10th, the defeated Muslims commenced with a greater fury, have been reminded by their religious leaders that whosoever dies in this battle will immediately go to heaven and receive a larger and a more merited reward in Muhammad's paradise of superlative bliss. The hostilities opened simultaneously in the city and out of the city. Some Assyrian troops were bringing ammunition to their comrades, who were being attacked within the walls of Urmia. They were intercepted by the horsemen of Karadag, who emerged from the fort they were holding and attempted to capture the ammunition and also the cannon, which they were bringing up at the call of Aga Petros. The Karadag warriors, under the Persian officers, were disastrously defeated and fled back into the shelter of the fort. The Assyrians planted their guns against the stronghold and then took it by assault. The famous horsemen paid heavy penalty for their treachery. Among the dead in the fort was found the body of Riza Khan, a Persian general. In the meanwhile, the men of Malik Khushaba at the southern gate and directly opposite of the ancient ramparts within the walls pushed back the troops of Arshad al-Mulk. They surrounded the ramparts and took that stronghold also by assault. The Assyrian troops stationed on the main street leading to the western gate, known as the Gate of Charbash, had penetrated further east into the city and pushed back the troops of Arshad al-Mulk. The Muslims were compelled to vacate the streets and conduct a guerrilla warfare from the roofs and the windows of their houses. Extremely anxious to save their lives of his men, Aga Petros issued orders to the troops to halt their advance. Now it was time for the batteries to bring the disciple governor and commander of the Muslim forces down on their knees. From the south, from the east and from the west, the batteries of Gugtapa and Deglala and Charbash roared, pouring a rain of shells into the eastern portion of the city. The 2-inch guns were of course more terrifying than destructive, but the weapons accomplished their purpose. The red flag of the jihad disappeared, and a white flag was raised instead. Ajal al-Mulk and Arshad al-Mulk surrendered unconditionally, and the firing ceased. Credit for this victory is again to be ascribed to the fearless warriors of Tiari, who had some time before taken by assault the mighty fortifications of Chal in Turkey, which were defended by braver men than these cowardly fanatics of the Persian Azerbaijan. Aga Petros immediately apprised his chief of the situation, and the patriarch was ready to receive the suppliant emissaries of peace. The final surrender of the Muslims, led by their priests, to accept the terms imposed by the Assyrian patriarch, by courtesy, near East Relief. The Muslim delegation looked more like a mob than a body of men suing for peace. The Persian general and his officers, the Mujtahids, or the high priests of Islam, the white turban Mawlis, priests, and the green garlanded Saids, who augustically claimed their descent from the Prophet of Arabia. Merchants, bankers, landlords, and representatives of all trades, all humble and humiliated, led by a white flag, marched through the streets of the city under the gaze of the very people whom they were going to exterminate, heart which the knowledge of Christ can generate. They came and fell prostrate in the presence of the Christian patriarch of the Assyrian people. If these men could become Christians, they would have an amazing vocabulary for prayer and supplication. In the hour of need, their vernacular supplies the richest expressions of appeal for mercy. They poured their pleadings at the feet of Marshamun with the same eloquence they had previously demonstrated, even though so hypocritically, in advising their co-religiousness to cultivate friendly relations with their Christian neighbors. But one of their poets has said, "The last end of a young wolf will be a wolf, even though the sons of men it shares its meat and its loaf." So while they trusted in the forgiving spirit of the Christian religion, and while they were certain that they would obtain the forgiveness they sought, still their wicked heart had never changed, nor could their seared conscience be awakened by the thunder of the roaring cannon. It was not a genuine repentance. It was simply a sense of fear and dread, and the patriarch, knowing this, granted their position on certain stipulated conditions.